We're getting back on track here with Kathryn and Emily, but as you know, we won't stay there for long because this is the Going Off Track podcast.
Hello, hello, and welcome back to the Going Off Track podcast. I'm Kathryn, and that's Emily, who is back from her deserted island vacation. Welcome back.
I am back. Thank you so much. Appreciate the co-host to help out. And for bearing with me on my ill-planned vacations. So, oops. You know, Emily likes to agree to trips and book and think later. And that's exactly what happened here. So, go team.
Well, you know, you only missed a decent race that had the crowning of a world champion and an absolute batshit ridiculous race.
I know.
That was a mess.
I know. I couldn't even like see them at all where I was. I had literally no internet, no connection. So yeah, it was poor timing on my part. But I did, once I got back, I saw all of the like funny drinking memes and videos about Max and like how someone was like, yeah, I'm pretty sure I saw him like drunk at 8 o'clock in the morning. He's like, yeah, of course I was drunk at 8 o'clock in the morning and I was still drinking.
Yeah.
So good for Max. Honestly, I hate to say it, but I'm like really warming up to Max just because I think I'm really seeing his character and like his I don't give two shits about anybody or anything and the humor and sarcasm he holds, and like that's just so near and dear to my heart.
You're seeing what I saw in 2021 when I took one look and said, I like this guy, he's an asshole.
Yeah, but like I think it took me a while to warm up to him just because like at that point it was the whole like Lewis versus Max thing, and right. It just something about me, it rubbed me the wrong way, but now I'm realizing like he just really doesn't care. Like he gets in the car, races, doesn't care about anybody else or anything else, and I think he's funny. I'm warming up to him. So
yeah, one of the things
I just want to, before you go into anything, I also did not miss on Instagram all of the just shade and shit thrown at Checo for how horrible he is. And I was like, this is making my life. Like, he is terrible. And I just literally, if he is driving next year, I can't.
We'll talk about those rumors
in a second.
I wanted to add in before we dive into the news of the week, and there's a fair amount, that one of the things that we were able to talk about while you were gone was Max Verstappen's new cat Donatello, or as Kelly Piquet, his partner's daughter Penelope, calls it, Donut, and we are obsessed.
I think Penelope has helped me warm up to Max. Because I see him in such a different light now that I started following Kelly on Instagram, like seeing Max and Penelope more, or P. It's so cute. I'm obsessed with their relationship, and I think she makes him a little bit more of a human. So good on her.
Yeah, I mean, with the kind of savant that he is, you kind of need someone who is, you know, normal and is as much of a race car dynasty supermodel girlfriend can be.
Oh, I think P grounds him, Penelope. Like,
oh yeah.
If a savant needs a 7-year-old to ground him, good for that. Good for them. But no, it's really sweet. It's super cute. And also, all of these F1 drivers have like random cats and dogs. They all have a ton of them. It's so funny.
I'm actually shocked at the number of cats. Yeah, Alex Albon just like has an entire farm.
Yeah,
but and like the fact that there's so many cats as owned by Formula One drivers is something that, like, I know a lot of men who have cats, but it just feels like there's a lot of them and they all drive in Formula One.
Well, I mean, logic here, right? Cats are easier to take care of.
Right.
And they're more independent, where dogs need a lot more attention. Like, Lewis's dog doesn't even live in London with him. Like, he lives with a random family in California. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Yeah. And so, and he'll just, like, come to races that are convenient to him. And then, like, in off season, I think he, like, picks them up and brings them back. But, like, for most of the time, he lives with, like, I don't know if it's a random family or, like, a family friends, but he lives
in
California.
It's probably friends. Yeah, that's amazing.
That's where he is. Yeah.
That is quite the early episode fun fact right there. Yeah. But going back to Verstappen and diving into news of the week, Max Verstappen's home race at the Dutch Grand Prix, Zandvoort, has announced an extension to their current contract through 2026, and then B, will be leaving the calendar after 2026. And I think that's kind of a bummer because that's actually a good race.
Yeah, I like Zandvoort. I just like the whole concept of it, of how everyone takes their bicycle to an F1 race. I love the oddity of that. But I am excited for what this will open us up to.
Right.
Malaysia. I know it won't be a Malaysian.
It won't be Sepang, but... No.
But we can see new races coming to the track. I know a while ago there were rumors about like the Chicago GP. Who knows? Should be exciting. And this is a decision that the track made, right? Like, this wasn't F1 removing it. The track just said, like, hey, we're leaving. We're not coming back.
Yeah, exactly. This was not, like, Formula One saying leave. And I don't think they would, especially as long as Max Verstappen is driving. And obviously, Max still has a contract with Red Bull through 2028. But you're right. It will open up an opportunity for another track on the calendar. Because I think at this point, they're not going to go back, you know, down from 24 races now that they've hit the, you know, perceived maximum. But it'll be interesting to see what replaces it. Could it be South Korea? Could it be a race in Africa? Could it be Turkey? You know, where would it be? What is this going to do to the calendar? And is this the first to come of tracks coming off the calendar? Because we've been seeing extension after extension after extension.
I know, we've only been seeing extensions. This is the first one that's like, we're leaving.
Yeah. And it's been extensions alongside, here are 400,000 different countries that want to join the calendar. So in order to join the calendar, you have to make room for it. So who is Zandvoort making room for? And I don't think we're going to hear about this for probably until like midway 2025. But
who do you want to see? Like, I know you want to see Malaysia, but like your realistic pick, who do you think is returning or coming to?
Realistically, I think this might be an opportunity for Formula One to go back to Africa somewhere. They had just announced that the track in South Africa that needs to be rated for Formula One again has gotten the funding or is going to be upgrading itself so it can be qualified for a Formula One race. So I think that that's a really good option. And I think marketing wise, it's a good option. Also, the FIA prize giving awards for this year for the first time are going to be in Rwanda in 2 weeks. I think it's on the 13th. So it's like 11 days, 10 soon. But I think that they're making more inroads back into Africa. And I think that that makes sense.
Yeah, I think them racing on every continent besides Antarctica, of course, is like a really cool feat and a really cool, you know, marketing scheme that they can hit with.
Yeah. And also gives other people the opportunities to go to races.
Mm-hmm. Of course. Yeah, for sure. Even though I feel like some races in Africa... Or if the race is in South Africa, some African countries are closer to other races than they would be to South Africa.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. The geography of Africa, of course, is Africa is a giant continent and not its own country. So, yes, South Africa would be geographically undesirable for, you know, the Northern African countries. But still, there has been a lot of talk.
It opens the door to a lot of people.
It opens the door. And also, like, obviously, we know Lewis Hamilton has been super passionate about getting the continent back onto the calendar. So I just feel like it makes more sense than, because yeah, there's Turkey, but there are so many other Formula One races near that part of the world. Yeah. But they don't, it's like, do we really need two Grand Prix in Italy? We really don't. We need Monza.
Do we really need three in the US? Like, I would, so thinking of this on the reverse, like, who do I think realistically could drop from the calendar?
Miami.
I never would have picked Zandvoort. Miami is number one for me, and then Imola.
Right, yeah.
Because I don't think we need Imola. Like, it has to be during a certain time because it's football season. And, like, but here's the thing. They'll never get rid of Miami, and they'll never get rid of Vegas because they're, like, the highest money grabs besides Monaco.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned that because one of the things about Vegas that – I'm pretty sure on purpose wasn't really talked about was there is a steep, like – drop in attendance in Vegas year over year. No one went.
You know why? Because it's too expensive.
Well, it's too expensive, and it's also way too late in the day. Like, a 10 o'clock race in Vegas, like, I know Vegas doesn't close, but it's like, Adam and I said that, like, had I not been dog-sitting at his mother's house, we would have just hopped in the car and gone to Vegas, but it, like, we would have just done it on a whim. It wouldn't be something that we would have, like, planned out months in advance. So I do know of a lot of people, at least last year, that, like, last minute got really cheap tickets and, you know, and just went. But I don't, and we talked about this on that recap episode, but I don't think that they're going to keep it on the strip after 2025 when that contract is up. If they keep it in Vegas, it will move somewhere off strip. And I don't know. Like, I do know that they want to keep the investment in it because it's Vegas. It's a Formula One's owned race. It's a big deal. But I think that they should focus elsewhere and just leave, you know, if we have to stick with Miami, let's stick with Miami. But also, like, we have COTA, and COTA is the best American Formula One race on the calendar.
Yeah. They've done a really good job with COTA and, like, bringing F1 back to the US. I just don't think we need three races. And, like, I would love to see a street race in Chicago. I would love to see that. But, like, I don't need Miami where they just drive around a stadium. And Miami, like, I don't know. It does nothing for me, but
well, the other issue all day long. Yeah, the other issue before we go on to the next bit is that the issues with Miami and Vegas are also their track configurations are not great. Vegas is slightly better than Miami, but Miami is really not a good track configuration. There's too many straights. It doesn't make for an exciting race like the COTA track does.
Agreed.
Yeah. Agreed. So we have a lot more thoughts on that, but we'll talk about that once we get more schedule news.
I'm going to just keep bringing us off track here.
That's okay.
We should do, like, our dream schedule. That's what we should do in the off season.
Maybe. Add it to the list.
Okay, yeah. You can move on now. I greatly
okay, so in the continuing adventures of the FIA's current implosion, which, Emily, you have seen little bits of as you have been away, but as we all know, Qatar was an FIA-induced mess, and they have proposed a new rules change, which is very ironic, and if you haven't heard about this, you've probably been living under a rock, but the new rules change would basically ensure that any ethics complaints are handled directly by the FIA president and the president of the Senate instead of an independent panel. Now, we all know that FIA president Mohammed Ben Sulayem is the most ethical person in Formula One, right? So he's the exact person who should be in charge of ethics complaints, right?
I mean, the logic checks out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So people are thrilled about this. And basically, the FIA is saying that they are not commenting on rules proposals, which basically means now that it's been leaked and everybody's mad about it, and this will lead to a war between the FIA and Formula One, they're probably going to backtrack this and we're not going to hear about it again.
Probably.
Because also, Mohammed Ben Sulayem is up for re-election after this year because he was elected in 2021 and he has 4-year terms.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, when is his election or when is the re-election or voting coming up on him? Because there's no way he stays.
It should be soon. Unfortunately, it does look like he would be sticking around from what little I've been able to. There hasn't been a lot about it because it's not that close. But yes, I don't think we're going to see the end of this disaster man anytime soon.
They have to see how bad it is. Like,
well, I don't think that the rest of the FIA are, you know, the paragons of virtue that he is not. This isn't just like
welcome
a top of the top of things podium.
How Kathryn really feels about the FIA president.
I, you know me and opinions. I have many of them, and I have very little by way of filter.
Yes, I know.
Oops,
I know. But I do think this is kind of weird. I think when you can have an independent panel or just independent people weigh in, I think that generally leads to a more favorable, not necessarily favorable, but a more fair outcome. I feel like this is not going to be independent, and I take issue with breaches of independence. So,
yeah, well, Yes. Yes, okay. Ethics, a thing that sports tends not to have. But anyway, let's talk about what Emily really wants to talk about right now.
This is all I've wanted to talk about with anyone for the last 2 weeks. Checo's out. I'm calling it. He's out at Red Bull. It's real. I don't care what anyone wants to say. His ass will not be in a seat next season.
Yes. So for context, late Sunday night, Monday morning, we started seeing rumors that allegedly stemmed from ESPN, which ESPN is a legitimate news source, saying that Checo will be out of a seat at Red Bull after Abu Dhabi. Obviously, we have heard statements from basically from both Helmut Marko and Christian Horner saying that they would talk about it in the shareholders meeting after Abu Dhabi. But something's got to give, and I don't think, for a few reasons, I don't think that this is just like a random news outlet picked this up and everybody else is picking on at it from the same source. I think that people are hearing this from a lot of different places, and I think it is feeling a lot more real than it did going into the summer. And we can only hope, because this man has only scored 2 points in the last 4 races, and this includes 1 point in the Sao Paulo sprint, and has not finished higher than P6 since his P4 finish in Miami.
I would also like to mention that he has single-handedly lost Red Bull the Constructors' Championship.
Not only that, but he has single-handedly cost Red Bull many millions of dollars by them finishing not first but third. And yes, there were rumors that he stayed on through the year because his very wealthy financial backers from Mexico are basically going to make up that money, but you can't really just have a Max Verstappen and then a non-Max Verstappen driver who isn't producing at all and then use sponsorship funds to make up for that prize money loss.
Which honestly, I think good on Red Bull for like turning down the money or ignoring it or accepting it and then getting rid of him anyways. But I appreciate this because the sport should be about like bettering the team and advancing and not just like, I don't know how to say this without like insulting Lance Stroll, but like not letting people just be in a seat because they can wave someone's money around. You know what I mean? Again, dig at Lance Stroll. But I understand what the sponsors are doing and trying to do. However, I think it's really important, like, for the integrity of the sport, for it not to happen. Because that's how you get, like, the Latifis to stick around and things like that. Just because you have money to throw, you shouldn't get a seat just because of that.
Yeah, and that opens up a whole, you know, other can of worms with, you know, pay drivers and the history of pay drivers and all that, which maybe we'll tackle one day in an F101.
Yeah, like, I don't have an issue with pay drivers, but, like, I do when they shouldn't be there. Like, Michael Schumacher was a pay driver, but he obviously deserved to be there. So
they just didn't know to start that he was going to become one of the best drivers in the history of the sport. So there, and like, obviously Sergio Perez is a really good driver who has had some, historically, he has been a very good driver who has had a career, but currently it's what are you doing for me lately? And for what we're doing right now with such a logjam of talent in the Red Bull stable, Red Bull really should take this opportunity to do something different, which I think that they are. And one of the reasons why I think we're seeing, you know, more of this news, and I think a lot of people have seen this, but Red Bull junior driver Isack Hadjar kind of didn't not confirm what his plans are for 2025 in the F2 press conference.
Word salad.
So much word salad. So you saw the video.
Yes. And everyone is just like interpreting it as whatever salad they want.
Right.
I think he started talking and he hasn't had enough media training to know when to stop talking. Yeah. Immediately I'm like, Kathryn is just, I know she's besides herself about his media training right now.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I mean, I think it's, but at the same time, it could have been like, I can't confirm because it hasn't been confirmed. Like, it could just be that he's a reserve driver. You know what I mean? Like,
right, exactly.
It could be a huge nothing burger. Now, do I hope that he actually has a seat so Checo leaves. Absolutely. But it's also interesting because, like, what are you going to do? Put Liam at Red Bull, who, like, hasn't been doing screamingly amazing to where I'm
but
like,
also that car is bad.
Over Checo's seat. Yeah, I know, but I want to see Yuki in a Red Bull, damn it.
I know, but I still think that it's not going to happen. So everybody was extrapolating from that little press conference clip that it means that Hadjar is going to go to VCARB and Lawson is going to go to Red Bull. And it fueled a lot of fire. Obviously, he's a half a point back in the championship behind future Sauber driver Gabriel Bortoleto, who was also in this little press conference, along with Paul Aaron, who is a future Alpine reserve driver, who is technically still mathematically in the competition for the F2 title with a very outside shot that I just don't see happening. But that's kind of the jokes were there. And so but it feels like from what the three of them were saying was like, he knows what he's doing next year. He just hasn't been able to talk about it yet because it hasn't been officially released by the teams yet. And so everybody is saying, oh, it's because he's going to VCARB.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I think it's interesting, though, because, like, Liam also doesn't have a seat confirmed yet next year.
Right. He doesn't, so, because they're waiting to figure all this out. So potentially it would be Verstappen, Liam Lawson at Red Bull next year, and then at VCARB, Yuki and Isack Hadjar. Franco Colapinto, who we love, who had such a great start, is no longer in the running because he crashed about 82 times in 2 weeks, which is unfortunate, but he's young. He'll make it onto the Formula One grid at some point eventually. And then there's also been this rumor that Valtteri Bottas is going
this
to
is
go
not
to
a
Red
rumor.
Bull.
This is so much more than a rumor. I'm like, I hate it, though. I don't like him at Red Bull. Like, I get it from the marketing perspective, but, like, I don't like this idea.
It's a really interesting idea. Obviously, he came out and said, like, people at Red Bull hate me, which I think is, like, overblowing things a little bit. But obviously, he was a Mercedes driver
right.
in the time where Mercedes was on such a high and Red Bull was, like, you know, scraping behind trying to, like, dig into this unbeatable monster of a team that Mercedes was during that tenure. But and the rumor, for those of you who missed it, is on the F1 merch website under Red Bull, the three drivers listed there are Max Verstappen, Sergio Perez, and Valtteri Bottas. I personally think that this was just a very coincidental glitch because I don't think that there's a world where if Bottas is in negotiations with Red Bull that anybody is going to come down and say, hey, just so you know, you need to prepare to get this guy onto our merch website from Sauber's. I just don't see that happening at all. Like, if this is in any way a negotiation, obviously the current, like, prevailing rumors that he's going to go back to Mercedes as a reserve driver. But I just don't think that anyone's going to say a goddamn word until there's ink on a contract.
And even when there is, I don't know if they'll announce it right away. I don't know. I think Red Bull is in such a weird spot where they can't say anything about anyone because they have no idea.
I think they have some idea. I just think that they can't talk about it until after the shareholders meeting in Abu Dhabi they can't do anything to get any balls rolling until they figure out what they're doing with Checo.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, there's just so much up in the air. Like, because that's a confirmed seat for next year, but it's, like, not, so.
Right. It's the most unconfirmed confirmed seat that we have on the grid.
Yeah.
So anyway, we'll see. But honestly, and I have said this many, many times before, and also going into the summer break, Red Bull needs to move on from Checo.
They should have moved on after summer break.
Yes, they never should have given him the 2-year extension with the way
that he's driving. No, it's dumb. Because here's the thing, like, Danny was given half a season or whatever in a VCARB, and then they pulled him.
Yeah.
And Checo's been given, 2 years to show that he can do something, and he can't. I don't know.
And I mean, it's not like to expect every year for both of your drivers to go 1-2 unless you are Mercedes in their heyday. But I mean, the fact that Checo, like I said, you need to be close and finishing P8. And of course, finishing the furthest away from your teammate since Jos Verstappen in 1994 with Michael Schumacher. Like, come on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know you had feels about that.
All right. Shall we get on to Abu Dhabi?
Yes, Abu Dhabi. So last year's podium was Max, Charles, George. And who knows, that could be the exact podium that we're going to see this weekend.
I hope
not. Or something near it. I don't know.
So this is exciting because I feel like a lot is going to happen this weekend because we have the battle for constructors because no one has outright won yet.
Nope.
Because if you guys all remember so vividly, we've had a winner or a constructor champion before Abu Dhabi for the last few years. So it's all coming down to the last race. And also we have a fight for drivers championship
for P2.
Max already won in Vegas, which also that's like probably the best place that you could win drivers and just like go out all night long.
Which I want to add something to that. People were saying after Vegas, like, why wasn't Max on the podium? Because Max didn't finish on the podium. Like, they even threw out the example of, like, how Zhou Guan Yu was recognized after the China race for, you know, being
different.
I agree. And, like, Max didn't want to be on that podium. He didn't care. No. He wanted to go out drinking with his friends. So, like, I think it's fine. Like, I think that what they did to acknowledge the world champion alongside the podium, I think it was fine. Like, Max didn't even want to be in the cool down, you know, Rolls Royce, which was weird enough as it is, but at least he had fun in his car with GP. Because I don't know if you saw the videos of the actual podium drivers in that car, because that was even more awkward than last year's with Max and Checo and Charles.
I just love watching Max and GP interact.
I know. They're great.
But yeah, okay. So to kind of like take a step back on constructors and drivers. So currently McLaren is in P1, but they're only up over Ferrari by 21 points, which is super attainable.
It's not easy for Ferrari, but...
No, but it's possible.
Yeah.
So that is really close. And then obviously behind Ferrari, you have Red Bull. So Red Bull will end up with P3, but who will be P1 and P2 will be determined this weekend. And then for drivers, Lando's only 8 points up on Charles. And I'm pretty sure Charles will, you know... do anything – sorry, I shouldn't say that. Fred will do anything to get Charles that P2, even if it includes sacrificing.
Of course. Yeah.
But that's the other thing, too, that I think is interesting, because we're going into the last race, and Ferrari could, in theory, win. But, like, do they prioritize that, or do they prioritize Charles if Carlos is in front of Charles? You know what I mean? Like, I feel like Ferrari's strategy – they're going to overthink everything and it's just going to come crumbling down. I hope not, obviously, but I feel like they're just going to overthink it and it's just going to be a mess.
Whatever they do, I hope that they do come into the weekend with a plan that the drivers are both clear on, because that's something that we clearly did not have in Vegas, which I know you saw the awkward aftermath, but they have to decide what they want to do, whether it's like, you know, focus on Charles and making sure that Charles is in the lead, or you know, making sure that Carlos knows that Charles needs to be in the lead. Obviously, yeah. This is also predicated on good qualifying. Fortunately, they are better in Abu Dhabi than they are in Qatar. But they need to come in with a plan that's agreed upon prior to the race so we don't have what happened in Vegas.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm not holding a lot of hope for that, but we'll see.
Yeah.
Okay. And then statistician Kathryn has done the math and the numbers on how all this can happen. So what does McLaren need to do, or what does Ferrari need to do in order to take the championship?
So basically all McLaren conceivably needs to do
constructors.
For the constructors, all McLaren conceivably needs to do is win the race. Like, if they win, they're done.
All you gotta do is win.
I know, right?
Easier. Win, 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 no matter
what. Yeah, I know. Easier said than done. They have to win with either car or score high. With, like, if they have a double podium, game over, or they score high, game over. Ferrari, in order to take the Constructors' Championship, would have to win and at minimum finish P3. If McLaren finishes P3, Ferrari would have to win and finish no longer than fifth with fastest lap or fourth without. So basically, Ferrari needs a double. It needs a 1-2, and McLaren just needs a 1, and also a good strong finish from the second driver, whoever that ends up being. But it will be easier for McLaren than it will be for Ferrari. Unless we see the McLaren we saw in Qatar, then it'll be easier for Ferrari.
I was gonna say, what if we get some DNFs?
If we get some DNFs, if any Ferrari DNFs, it's game over. If any McLaren
does it.
There's still a chance for a McLaren, even if one of the drivers does DNF. But it'll be really interesting to see. And I don't think we're really going to know until the finish line that who's going to win this. So that'll be really exciting to look out for all that the Constructors' Championship isn't nearly as exciting for as the drivers.
Yeah. Also, something to look for in Constructors. Bishop's dinner.
No, it's 9:30.
Oh, I thought I heard Bishop's dinner. My bad. No. Anyway, so another thing to look out for in Constructors, which I know it's not like super exciting because it's not the winner P1 to P2. However, there is a battle for P6, and you have to remember the jump from like P10 to P9 to P8, all of those is millions of dollars, which helps them a ton. So there is a battle for P6 that we should keep an eye out for. So Alpine is at 59 points. Haas is at 54, which is super close. Only 5 points separate them for P6. And then VCARB is also there with 46 points. But I think the real battle is going to be between Alpine and Haas. And these are two very inconsistent teams.
Right.
So I feel like anything could happen here. Even with VCARB, who knows? I mean, the car sucks, but...
VCARB would need a miracle to really put themselves seriously back into this battle for P6. Obviously, if Haas is a terrible day and VCARB has a good day, then they could conceivably get to P7. Mm-hmm. But what's really interesting here, and this is something that we've been talking about basically since the end of the Qatar race, is what Alpine is doing right now with Esteban Ocon. So for those of you who are, as I've said, living under a rock, Esteban Ocon was announced early Monday morning that he would not be racing for Alpine in Qatar, and may or may not have fired himself, or maybe Alpine finally just got rid of him. It was very messy as hell. Fernando Alonso and Oscar Piastri.
Yeah, like, I don't know, again, I don't understand how Alpine does business or how they function, because it seems like they just willy-nilly fire people when they're upset.
See their team principals
at Spa. But like, Esty Besty removed a ton of stuff Alpine from his Instagram. He took it off of his bio right away. So I don't feel like this was a mutual decision whatsoever.
Well, the statement that he put out basically implied that it wasn't.
Yeah.
And it's, it's just, it's interesting in a lot of ways, because obviously Alpine and Haas are fighting. Who is going to Haas next year? Esteban Ocon. One of the reasons why this is happening is so that Ocon can prepare for the postseason test in Abu Dhabi with Haas, which he conceivably could have raced in Abu Dhabi and then, switch underoos and put on the Haas race suit. But he doesn't have a good relationship with Alpine, so they decided to gamble. Because
it's like the same thing with Carlos. Like, Carlos is doing postseason testing in Abu Dhabi with Williams, but
he's also racing for Ferrari.
In.
Right. Yeah. So it's been very messy over there. I think that a lot of this, is a lot influenced by Flavio Briatore, who's back with the team as a senior advisor or executive advisor, whatever. But I do think that, and this happened, I believe, like early mid-season, and he's really kind of kicking in a lot of doors and making a lot of changes that will lead into hopefully a steadier organization in 2025 and on. But in this really tight battle with Haas, I don't know if you want to get rid of an experienced driver when you only have 5 points between you and your opponent in favor of an admittedly talented rookie who, you know, and let, like, I know that Vic Gasly has been finishing, you know, podium in Sao Paulo, P5 in Qatar, but like, it hasn't been consistent for all that the car is so much better than it was at the beginning of the year. And I don't know if you want to put all of that on Gasly.
No, I don't. I mean, especially like you were saying, when you're battling for constructors, like, why are you doing this? But I don't know. Maybe who knows? We don't know. We're not in the room when it happens. So
right.
We can only just, you know.
That said, it's really excited that Jack Doohan is finally going to be driving. He's one of the most promising reserve drivers. Yeah. And it's very exciting that he's going to be in the car and we're going to see him and get a preview of what we're going to see from him next year. And hopefully he does well. He has experience in F1 cars on this track. He has done testing in Abu Dhabi in Formula One cars. So it's not like he's going in cold, like, say, Franco Colapinto in some of the tracks that he's been on this year. But it's still a very interesting gamble. This opens the door for Haas to do something, perform well. I think Nico Hülkenberg is going to want to go out on a high, especially after his poor finish in the Qatar Grand Prix race and Kevin Magnussen in his conceivably last race as a Formula One driver and most experienced Haas driver in the history of their team. He's also going to, you know, want to try to go really well or just, you know, be the chaos magnet we know and love.
Yeah, so you bring up a really good point. This is kind of like the last hurrah for a lot of people this weekend. So this is Lewis Hamilton's last race as a Mercedes driver, which is insane, and I'll come back to that in a second. But this is also Carlos Sainz's last race in Ferrari, Nico Hülkenberg's last race at Haas, Valtteri Bottas' last race at Sauber, and K-Mag's last race.
It's Joe Guanyu.
That's what I meant. Joe Guanyu's last race. K-Mag's last race.
Franco Colapinto.
Well, yeah, that's... It could be Liam Lawson's last race. We don't know.
Yeah.
Just like there's a lot of that going on this weekend. But I think the one to really highlight is definitely Lewis Hamilton. I mean, he's been with Mercedes for, 12 seasons now? It's his 246th race with one team. That's an F1 record. He's just so decorated at Mercedes. I never thought I'd see the day where Lewis Hamilton was not a Mercedes driver.
Right. It's like, even if you like take out his non-Mercedes years, which was just his tenure at McLaren, like he's still one of the best drivers in Formula One just with his time in Mercedes. 6 world championships, 8 constructors championships, 84 race victories, and 1 vendetta with Nico Rosberg.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Speaking of Nico Rosberg. So Mercedes like had people, fans enter their names to be on Lewis Hamilton's like farewell car because they're doing like 150 names on the farewell car. And someone on like, I don't know if it was...
It was Instagram. I think I sent
Instagram.
It to you.
Well, but I saw another one too. Mm. Like people were like, how much do I have to start paying people to submit Nico Rosberg's name? which like I think is so funny. If his name is on the car, it won't be, but it's a good laugh for sure. But yeah, so we'll see how it goes.
Yeah. And then speaking of other people going into the cars, we have a ton of FP1 rookie participants, which makes sense. Like they tend to like save a bunch of them for the end of the year. Like there were even more last year than there are this year. Mm-hmm. This year, Red Bull, Isack Hadjar, who we already talked about earlier, will be in for Max Verstappen, who very hilariously said that he will be skipping the postseason test because he's like, yeah, I skip this like every year now. I don't care. I'm not even going to watch this year, which I thought that was really funny. For Williams, Luke Browning will be in the car for Alex Albon, and he's making his F1 practice debut along with Ryo Hirakawa for McLaren. He'll be in for Oscar Piastri, and then we'll also be testing for Haas. And Arthur Leclerc will be in the Ferrari for Carlos Sainz, which will make them the first sibling pair to drive for a Ferrari, because obviously he will be driving alongside his brother Charles Leclerc. We will also have another appearance of Ayumu Iwasa in the VCARB. He'll be driving this time for Yuki Tsunoda. Obviously, last time it was for Daniel Ricciardo. And for Aston Martin, we have Felipe Drugovich, who will be driving for Lance Stroll.
I don't know. I mean, this whole Arthur thing, like, nepotism at its finest. Yeah, I don't get it, but whatever.
We joke about the nepotism, and then there's Lance Stroll exists.
Yeah, but, like, I don't know. We all know it. That's just out in the open, and it's like, he's not that. I mean, he's not a great driver, but he's also not the worst.
Right.
Depending on the weekend, I guess. But the whole Arthur thing, like, he hasn't really done anything, but.
Not since his F2 days, but, you know, it are what it be, and it will be a nice opportunity for both of the brothers to be driving on the Formula One track at the same time. I'm sure the last time we had siblings was, like, the Schumachers with Michael and Ralph.
Yeah. Well, my light burnt out, so.
Uh-oh.
I'm in the dark now, but. All right, I think it's time for us to get to our predictions because we've already talked for 40 minutes. So,
of course, as we tend to do.
So, last one of the season, Kathryn, who is your pole sitter for Abu Dhabi?
I picked Charles Leclerc.
Love that for everybody. So, I have Max, which, like, I know. I'm just still on the Max train, I guess. But
I mean, Max is more of a legitimate idea these last few weeks. I mean, honestly, this last triple header than he had been for weeks, you know, leading into it. We'll see. As I said, in Qatar, I really didn't think he was going to win a race again after Sao Paulo just because of how much he benefited from the weather.
Yeah.
But, you know, as we've seen, anything can happen.
Yeah. Okay, then for your podium, who do you have?
I have a Charles Leclerc, Oscar Piastri, Carlos Sainz podium. So I am going for the Ferrari overtake.
So I am as well, but differently. So I have Max, Charles, Carlos. So I'm going to say that it's a double Ferrari podium.
Okay, that would give Ferrari the lead over McLaren if there's no McLarens on the podium, I believe, probably. Math is hard.
And then we also pick P10. So P10 is the last position on the grid where you get points. You get 1 point for P10. We give ourselves 3 because it's very difficult. So who is your P10 for the grand finale?
So my P10 is purely wish fulfillment. Based off of last week, which was close but no cigar, I really want Valtteri Bottas to have a point. This season. So I am picking him.
That's a good one.
I really, after what happened last week in Qatar, I just really want it to happen for him. I think that they can make it happen. And it would be really nice to see him go out of his probable F1 career for now with a point on the board this season so that he will not be 22nd in a 20 driver championship.
God bless.
Yeah.
Well, but also... If Jack Doohan scores a point, he just falls further down.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah. Yeah. Who knows?
So mine is also, you know, great, great wishing. Just because I think it would be funny to go out with a bang and Checo gets P10. Because mostly because I just wanted to open the can of worms of drama where it's like, well, I scored a point. Like, I'm scoring points. Got one measly point.
And he gets really 26, want, like, you get one.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I want to see. So,
yeah.
Instigator Emily over here.
Yeah, of course.
And then just for fun, Kathryn and I do what's going to be the biggest surprise of the weekend and who's going to do an oops. So for mine, I don't necessarily know if it's like a big surprise, but I think this is going to be, I know that I was talking crap about them earlier, but Ferrari, I think, is just going to run away with it. I think they're going to take the championship, and I think Charles is going to hop Lando and get P2 as well. So we were like riding this high all season, or not all season, but second half of the season, where it's like, oh my gosh, Red Bull's not going to win. It's going to be McLaren. And McLaren seemed unstoppable. And then all of a sudden, I feel like they just kind of ran into a brick wall a bit. And I think Ferrari's kind of just been gathering those sneaky points. Not sneaky, because it's very obvious, but they've held their own against Red Bull and McLaren when we generally, I think, write them off sometimes because they make stupid mistakes. But I think it's going to pay off.
So. Yeah, I think that it's going to be really interesting, and I think that that would be really fun if that happens. My big surprise is I would be surprised if the race director doesn't screw this up again. I think that's not a very good track record, but I think it's going to be really interesting.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. And then who do you have for who's going to do a dumb?
My dumb is, I think something avoidable is going to happen that's going to stop Bottas from getting into the points.
You're just really on the Bottas train.
I really want this to happen for him. And I also really want to know, as he's, you know, been tattooing all over himself, what's next?
I know. I just want to know what's next. Tell me what's next, Valtteri. Okay, so I have, kind of in line with what I've been talking about this whole time, I have that McLaren is just going to implode. I think they've been like riding this high, and Zach's been like, yeah, we're going to win driver or constructors, and Lando's in contention for drivers. And I think they're just going to implode this weekend, and it's all going to blow up in Zach's face.
Well, we shall certainly see.
Okay. Last but not least, we do have one more thing to cover. Thanks for hanging in there with us for 46 minutes so far. Kathryn, we need an F1 Academy update, because, like, what the heck happened with Abbi Pulling?
Yes. So this has been really interesting. So first and foremost, Abbi Pulling won the F1 Academy Drivers' Championship, except she didn't, because she was crowned after race one in Qatar, as we expected, and then race two was canceled, but she was already announced as the champion because mathematically she won, and then they canceled the race afterwards because there was a crash in the Porsche Super Cup Support Series race prior to the race on Sunday. So anyway, they just announced today, yesterday, somewhat recently, that they have added a third race to the Abu Dhabi calendar, which mathematically gives Dorian Pan, who's currently P2 in the championship, an outside chance to overtake Abbi if she wins all three races and has pole in all three races and Abbi finishes outside of the points, which is conceivably possible, but highly unlikely, but is been very interesting to be like, congratulations, you're the champion. Oh, wait, no, you're not. But anyway, we'll see. Other exciting things related to Abbi Pulling. Abbi Pulling is the current Alpine driver. She will be moving to GB3 next year with Rodin Motorsport, which is her current team. But that will leave an opening for the Alpine F1 Academy racer, which will be filled by our favorite wildcard driver. We've finally gotten the announcement that Nina Gaidman will be succeeding her in 2025 at Alpine for the F1 Academy. So I'm really, really excited to see that happen, see that official, because we all kind of knew it was going to happen because she was so good in F1 Academy in Zandvoort. So very exciting for her.
Okay. And then also, as we've discussed for all of the race weekends with F1 Academy, they do have a wild card spot open. So who is the wild card? Who are they racing under? Give us her information.
Yeah. So the wild card drivers have been typically driving under one specific brand partnership, but we have a new brand partnership for this one, this Away, the luggage company. And the driver is Logan Hanna, who is a Scottish driver. She'll be the wild card driver in Abu Dhabi. She moved to single seaters in 2017. She is the first female driver to compete in Formula 4 UAE and has already participated in some F1 Academy testing in this track in Abu Dhabi back in October, which I think really speaks to them getting her in the car next year. And more importantly, we have confirmed that they will continue doing these wildcard driver seats for the 2025 calendar. So we will continue to see more female drivers not included on the current calendar slate. Obviously, we have, I think, about a third of the drivers already announced for next year. So it'll be interesting to see as we go into the off season who is going to move to what team, who is going to be moving out of F1 Academy, who's going to be moving in. So we have a lot to come for F1 Academy. And we also have a potential crowning for Abbi Pulling this weekend in one of the three races that F1 Academy will be doing, which is not uncommon because they had three races in the 2023 schedule. Mm. Every race weekend was three races. So this is kind of going back to that one so that they have basically all of the races that they kind of quote unquote promised us going into the season. And I had one more thing and I forgot, but we've been talking for almost an hour. So we're going to move on. And if I remember it, we'll talk about it in the reaction episode.
Okay. So moral of the story, lot's going to happen this weekend.
Yes.
We're going to actually get a constructor champion. We'll figure out where the driver's championship stacks up with Max winning, obviously, but where everyone else is going to fall. Hopefully Valtteri Bottas scores a point. I'm very excited. I think it's going to be – I have very high hopes for this race weekend. So we'll see.
I do too. And based on – just everything that, I mean, if you want to know what happened, you know, last week in Qatar and you haven't already watched our reaction episode with me and Paul, just watch that for our thoughts on the race director, Rui Marquez, and how bad that was. And I really hope we don't have that again this weekend because it did take away a lot from the racing itself. And I really hope that Abu Dhabi is just a good Abu Dhabi race. And obviously we've had some interesting Abu Dhabi races.
See, girls can dream.
No, Michael, no, that is so not right, which girls I just keep for reference on my desk. But I just really hope we don't have a race director, you know, complete disaster like we did last week. Let's get their, like, they can get their house in order during the off season, but let's not have the same interference that we had in Qatar. Let's do what we had in Vegas, which was fine. And also, yeah, no one place grid penalties for things that aren't actually penalties, because that was just dumb.
Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the end of the episode, but before we leave you guys, we need to hear Catherine's F1 fun fact. So Catherine, what is your F1 fun fact for this weekend for us?
So our F1 fun fact for this weekend is for Lewis and is kind of interesting. Lewis will be changing, for the first time in his Formula One career, will be changing engine manufacturers. So now that he is leaving Mercedes, he is going to Ferrari. Obviously, Ferrari is their own engine manufacturer. But even when he was a McLaren driver, who was supplying for McLaren, who is still supplying for Mercedes. So he's going to have a new experience with engine suppliers starting in 2025.
Wow, that's a good F1 fun fact. And I love that you're just, you know, forced to talk more about Lewis Hamilton. So.
Yes, yes, I am saying things about Lewis Hamilton. It is not exactly a nice thing. It is a factually neutral thing.
You voluntarily chose a Lewis Hamilton F1 fun fact.
Yes, that is true. I mean, the 2023 season was mostly just weeks and weeks and weeks of Max Verstappen fun facts. So there you go, Lewis.
There you go. I mean, imagine how much people are going to talk to him when he's like actually retiring, because I feel like it, just him switching teams is so monumental and everyone like won't shut up about it. Just imagine when he actually retires.
So I now that you mentioned that, I really hope that he doesn't do a farewell tour of a season. Like, I'm retiring next season. I hope that he announces at the whatever season he announces it, I hope he does it at the end, because I can understand.
Like what Seth did it with like a third of the season left or whatever.
Yeah, let's like not do a, like, let's not announce it in February of, hey, 2027 is going to be my last season, because I would cry, because every race would be like, this is the last time that Lewis Hamilton is going to breathe in Silverstone. And it's just, it's here's every. So like, I can live with it for a few races. I do not want 24 races of the Lewis Hamilton farewell tour. But yeah, I think that would be very interesting.
Well, anyways, we will see how that goes in the future, because we are the podcast that only talks about the future and we don't talk about anything happening in the current season.
Why would we?
So up next, we will have our Abu Dhabi recap episode that'll be out on Monday. Make sure that you follow us on socials. Kathryn keeps everything so up to date because she's so on top of everything.
Thank you.
But that has been our Abu Dhabi predictions episode. Thanks for going off track with us, guys.